Good afternoon, everybody. We will just take a few moments to allow the rest of the attendees to join the webinar. Thank you. Good afternoon, and welcome to this webinar about the NEA's American Rescue Plan Grants to Organizations program. Please type any questions in the Q&A area at the bottom of your screen, and we will get through as many as possible. We will also share our contact information at the end of today's presentation. Please note, this webinar is being recorded and will be archived on our website. Closed captioning and ASL interpretation will also be available for the duration of the webinar. In order to enable closed captions, please click on the closed caption icon on the bottom of your screen and enable subtitles. To kick off today's presentation, please welcome the Chief of Staff of the National Endowment for the Arts, Rod Joy.
Hello, everybody. My name is Rod Joy. I serve as Chief of Staff at the National Endowment for the Arts, and I'm very pleased to help welcome you to today's gathering. The purpose of this virtual session is to provide more information about the NEA's American Rescue Plan funds. Over the course of the next 60 minutes or so, we'll have an opportunity to do a deep dive on our ARP program, the structure, eligibility, application guidelines, and awards. We know that to put an end to this pandemic, it means getting creative workers back to work. And before the pandemic hit, the arts and cultural sector was approaching a $1 trillion industry that directly employed 5.2 million people and indirectly supported millions more. As you know, few sectors of our economy have been hit harder by COVID-19 than the arts. Cultural organizations were among the first businesses that were forced to shut down when the pandemic began, and they'll be among the last to fully reopen. In the third quarter of 2020, while the national unemployment rate was 8.5%, musicians experienced an unemployment rate of 27.1%, actors 52.3%, and dancers and choreographers 54.6%. On March 11th, President Biden signed into law the American Rescue Plan Act of 2021, the second largest stimulus package in legislative history. We are grateful to the president and to Congress that this relief package includes resources to help arts organizations and arts workers hard hit by COVID-19. This includes $135 million for the National Endowment for the Arts. The goal for the NEA's American Rescue Plan program is to support relief and recovery for arts organizations across the country. We want to preserve jobs and help arts organizations rehire and reopen. The second goal for our ARP program is to expand access to funds for communities that have been historically underserved by government. On April 29th, the Arts Endowment announced the distribution of approximately $52 million to state and regional arts agencies so that they could begin distributing funds to impacted arts organizations in their jurisdiction. And on June 23rd, the Arts Endowment announced two new grant programs to deploy approximately $80 million in American Rescue Plan funds to the field. We'll be talking a lot more about those programs today. Over the course of the last several months, we've done a lot of listening. We've met with and listened to arts administrators, leaders at arts agencies and service organizations, and we asked some very pointed questions. We asked for feedback on what worked and perhaps what didn't work for the NEA's rollout of the CARES Act program. And we heard a number of consistent themes. Again and again, we were encouraged to embed fairness and equity into the ARP program design and every aspect of the funding cycle. Before I turn it over to my colleagues, I just want to point out three key differences for the American Rescue Plan, things that are distinct from the CARES Act of 2020 and even the American Revitalization and Recovery Act of 2009. Those three distinctions are wider eligibility, greater flexibility, and a focus on locals. In terms of wider eligibility, we want to open the doors of opportunity to more arts organizations across the country, organizations that have never received a grant from the NEA or even a grant from the federal government are eligible to apply for funds. We want to provide greater flexibility. So Congress has charged the Arts Endowment with allowing grant recipients to use ARP funding to cover general operating expenses, and there is no matching grant requirement. And we want to focus on locals, recognizing the unique role that local arts agencies play in the overall arts ecosystem. We view this step as a chance to have a national bottom-up approach to providing recovery and relief to the field. Now that our ARP guidelines are posted, our focus is on getting dollars out the door to nonprofit theaters, museums, dance companies, symphonies, and other cultural organizations all across the country. This webinar is just one in a series of opportunities to learn more about our ARP program. I want to thank you for taking time to be with us here today. I want to thank you for all that you do to activate the power of the arts in your community. And at this time, I'm pleased to turn it over to Cliff Murphy, the NEA's Director of Folk and Traditional Arts. Thank you all.
Thank you, Ra. Hi, everybody. I'm Cliff Murphy, the NEA's Director of Folk and Traditional Arts. I'm on your screen in a brown suit with a greenish tie, black glasses, and what's left of a dark head of hair. I'm joined today by Director of Music and Opera, Ann Meyer Baker, Arts Education Specialist, Nancy Doherty, and Lead Grants Management Specialist, Meg Kowalik. We're thrilled you've joined us, and we especially want to welcome anyone who's thinking about applying for an NEA grant for the first time. There will be lots of time for questions after the presentation, and I see we have a number of questions that are already coming in the Q&A box. If you're a new applicant, please let us know. In a moment, you should see a simple polling question asking, to your knowledge, has your organization ever submitted an application for NEA support? Please check your response when you see the survey. If your answer is no, that's okay. We just want to get a better understanding of who's tuned in today. Your responses are anonymous, and they won't appear on the screen. So I'm going to pause for just a moment here. All right, now if you remember only one thing from this webinar, we hope that it's this. We understand that applying for federal funding and managing a grant can be a significant undertaking. We strive as an agency to ensure that all applicants receive the support they need throughout this process. We welcome the opportunity to connect with you. The National Endowment for the Arts is an independent federal agency. We provide funding for the arts in all 50 states, Washington, D.C., and U.S. territories. Each year, we award thousands of grants to provide all Americans with diverse opportunities for arts participation. Please check out the grants section of our website at arts.gov for a listing of our regular grant programs, and don't hesitate to reach out with any questions you might have. We encourage you to learn about these other grant programs, and we look forward to supporting you through the grants process. The American Rescue Plan is designed to fuel the nation's recovery from the devastating economic and health effects of the COVID-19 pandemic. funds allocated to the NEA in this historic legislation represent a significant commitment to the arts and a recognition of the value of the arts and cultural sector to the nation's economy and recovery. Rescue Plan funding is available through two separate competitive opportunities: grants to organizations, which is what today's webinar is focusing on, and grants to local arts agencies for subgranting. A special note to any local arts agencies tuning in: if you meet the eligibility requirements as a local arts agency, you may apply to the Grants for Organizations program for general operating support, or to the grants to local arts agencies for a subgranting program, but you cannot submit an application to both. The Grants to Organizations program will be carried out through one-time grants to eligible organizations to support their own operations. Unlike other NEA funding programs that offer project-based support, Rescue Plan funds are intended to support day-to-day business expenses or operating costs and not specific programmatic activities. I know that for many who have been applying for support from us in the past, this is a shift, but please take note of that. So applicants must be nonprofit tax-exempt 501c3 U.S. organizations, units of state or local government, or federally recognized tribal communities or tribes. Applicants may include, but are not limited to, arts organizations, local arts agencies, arts service organizations, and other eligible organizations. We do not fund direct grants to individuals. The applicant organization must have completed a 3-year history of arts programming prior to August 12, 2021. For the purpose of defining eligibility, 3-year history refers to when an organization began its programming and not when it incorporated or received nonprofit tax-exempt status. Programming is not required to have taken place during consecutive years. If your programming has been disrupted due to COVID, there are flexibilities described in the guidelines. Applicants must also be up to date with reporting requirements for any previous NEA grant. We are committed to diversity, equity, and inclusion, and fostering mutual respect for diverse beliefs and values. We intend to make awards that will impact a broad constituency. We encourage applications from a variety of eligible organizations, including organizations that serve populations that are underserved, such as those whose opportunities to experience the arts are limited by ethnicity, economics, geography, or disability. Organizations with small and medium-sized budgets, organizations from rural to urban communities, and organizations that may be applying for federal support through the NEA for the first time. At this point, I'd like to turn it over to Meg. Meg?
Thank you, Cliff. My name is Meg Kowalik. I'm a lead grants management specialist in the Office of Grants Management here at the NEA. So for the American Rescue Plan grants, organizations may submit only one application to this program. Exceptions to the one application rule are made only for parent organizations applying on behalf of one or more separately identifiable and independent components. Eligible organizations that received CARES Act funding from the NEA may apply to this program as long as there are no overlapping costs during the same grant period. Eligible local arts agencies may apply either to the Rescue Plan's grants to local arts agencies for a subgranting program or to this program for general operating support, but not both. You may apply to other NEA funding opportunities for which your organization is eligible, including grants for arts projects. In each case, the applications cannot have any overlap in costs during the same grant period. You may request a grant amount of $50,000, $100,000, or $150,000. Applications will be reviewed and considered for recommendation only at one of these requested amounts. Cost share or matching funds are not required. We encourage you to select a grant amount that is reflective of your organization's size and internal capacity. Applications will be reviewed and considered for recommendation at the requested amount only. Whichever amount you choose, keep in mind the review criteria when crafting your application to make the best case for the panel. Your application will be evaluated based on the capacity of your organization to carry out the proposal. A grant period of up to 2 years is allowed, and that grant period may start no earlier than January 1st, 2022. Rescue plan funds are intended to support day-to-day business expenses or operating costs and not specific programmatic activities. Please read the guidelines carefully for details about what costs we can support. Support is limited to any or all of the following: salary support, full or partial, for one or more staff positions. Rescue plan funds may be used to support existing jobs, new jobs, or to restore jobs that were furloughed or eliminated due to the pandemic. Support is also available for fees or stipends for artists and/or contractual personnel to support the services they provide for specific activities as part of your organization's operations. These artist fees or stipends should be related to work with a tangible outcome, such as performances, presentations, workshops, and/or the creation of artwork. We can also support facilities costs, such as mortgage principal, rent, or utilities. Also, costs associated with health and safety supplies for your staff or for your visitors or audiences. This would be things such as personal protective equipment, cleaning supplies, hand sanitizer, etc. And lastly, we can also support marketing and promotion costs for your organization. One type of cost isn't preferred over another. It's up to your organization to choose which costs to include in the budget and to make the case in the application as to why they are important in relation to the review criteria. Think about where the funds may make the most impact for your organization or fill a gap that is not currently being funded through other sources. And now I will turn it over to my colleague, Arts Education Specialist, Nancy Doherty.
Thank you, Meg. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm an Arts Education Specialist, as Meg said, and I am wearing a light lavender V-neck shirt with a glass pendant. I have blonde shoulder-length hair and blue reading glasses. All applications are reviewed by advisory panels made up of diverse groups of citizens from across the country. Panelists will consider the review criteria of artistic excellence and artistic merit, including the proposal's significance to the mission and core work of the organization, the ability to carry out the award as shown by the alignment of the budget and other resources with the goals and requirements of the ARP funding opportunity, as appropriate, potential to have an immediate impact on the arts workforce, and as appropriate, the potential to serve and/or reach individuals whose opportunities to experience the arts are limited by ethnicity, economics, geography, or disability. Panel recommendations will be shared with the National Council on the Arts, which then makes recommendations to the Arts Endowments Chairman. The chairman reviews the council's recommendations and makes the final decisions on all grant awards. Submitting an application is a multi-step process. For part one, you will submit the application for federal domestic assistance short organization form to grants.gov. This is a brief form that will collect very basic information about your organization. For part two, you will fill out the grant application form in the NEA's applicant portal. This web form is where you will enter the majority of your application materials, such as the proposal description and budget information. Grants.gov and the Arts Endowments applicant portal are two separate online systems. So in order to use Grants.gov, you must first obtain a DUNS number from Dun & Bradstreet and then register with the System for Award Management, also known as SAM.gov. If you are a first-time applicant, start this process now, and you'll need to allow at least 2 weeks for your SAM.gov registration or renewal. You will also need to ensure that your organization is registered with Grants.gov. As a reminder, SAM.gov and Grants.gov are federal government systems, and registration in both of these systems is always free. The guidelines on our website have links to these sites, as well as links to video tutorials to help you get started. The NEA staff does not have internal access to SAM or Grants.gov, so if you run into technical difficulties with either entity, you should reach out to their help desks directly by telephone or email. So because we anticipate a large number of applications for this funding opportunity, applications will be submitted in two separate groups, one for organizations with legal names beginning with the letters A through L, and one for organizations with legal names beginning with the letters M through Z. The different submission windows will not affect the timing of grant review or your organization's ability to receive a grant. To determine which group applies to you, use your organization's legal name as it appears in your current IRS 501c3 status letter or in the official document that identifies your organization as a unit of state or local government or a federally recognized tribal community. Please do not use your organization's popular name if that is different. If you aren't sure which group to select, take a look at the guidelines for some helpful tips, or please contact us. So both the A through L group and the M through Z group will have the same Part 1 Grants.gov deadline, and that deadline will be August 12, 2021. And then the Part 2 deadlines for the A through L and M through Z groups will be different. So for Part 1, A through L will apply on August 12th, and then they will have a window of time for Part 2 between August 19th through 25th, and the application must be completed by 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time on August 25th. For the group M through Z, once again, Part 1 is submitted through grants.gov no later than August 12th at 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time. And then the window for Part 2 to submit to the applicant portal is August 27th through September 2nd, 2021, no later than 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time. Please contact us if you're unsure of which group to select or if you have any questions at all. And now I'm going to hand the microphone over to my colleague, Ann Meyer Baker.
Thank you so much, Nancy. I'm glad to be with you today. I'm Ann Meyer Baker. I'm the director of music and opera. I have a navy blue blouse on and tortoiseshell glasses. So I'm eager to tell you more about the guidelines. The guidelines are available on our website, which is arts.gov. Click the menu button at the top right of the homepage and then click on grants. Next, scroll down to the American Rescue Plan grants, and then select grants to organizations. Please carefully read the program description and review the other links on the left side of the page for information such as eligibility requirements and application deadlines. If you need to reach us, click on contacts. Now to access the application instructions, please go to How to Apply page, Part one instructions will walk you through how to submit to grants.gov. Part two instructions will walk you through how to submit to the NEA's applicant portal. Click the link to the part two PDF instructions. Even though you won't have access to the applicant portal until the dates we showed you before, all of the application questions are available now in this PDF. So you can prepare your application early and expand that window of time you have. The PDF includes instructions for accessing the applicant portal. Now we encourage you to go to the applicant resources area in the guidelines. Technical assistance resources include FAQs, an applicant checklist, a summary of common application mistakes, a grant application form tutorial, grants.gov and sam.gov resources, instructional videos, signups for live online applicant Q&A sessions with our staff, and many other items. Please check it out. Now the FAQ section on the website covers a lot of ground, but we want to highlight just a few frequently asked questions now. For example, can I apply to ARP if I have already applied for another NEA grant this year or other federal relief funds such as SVOG or PPP? The answer is yes, you can. However, it's important to remember that you cannot use multiple federal grants to fund the same activities or costs. Each grant should be funding something different. Additionally, you can't use ARP funds or other federal funds in order to meet a matching requirement of other NEA grant programs such as grants for arts projects. The next question is, are work samples required for the ARP applications? And the answer is no. You will not be required to submit work samples or other support materials. Rescue plan funds are for specific general operating costs only. What's the difference between project-based support and general operating grants? Well, while the rescue plan funds may support work that goes into programmatic activity, these grants are not program-based. In a project-based grant, all of the costs must relate to the execution of a specific project. In an operations-based grant, which ARP is, eligible costs are not tied to a specific project. For example, you may include staff salaries for your curatorial team, as well as artist fees, stipends for teaching artists in your education department, even if these people will not be working together on the same activities. Similarly, fees and stipends for artists and/or contractual personnel must support the services they provide for specific activities as part of organizational operations. Now, before we get to your questions, here are a few things to remember. First, if you aren't registered with DUNS, SAM, or grants.gov, get started now. Second, late applications are not accepted. So be sure that your application is complete and submitted on time. Submit part one well in advance of the August 12 deadline to give yourself ample time to resolve any issues. Likewise, please submit your part two materials to the applicant portal well in advance of the deadline. It's no surprise that the hours of heaviest usage are generally 8 p.m. to 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time on the day of the deadline. Please avoid using the system at that time if possible. Each year, we sadly have applicants that wait until the last minute and unfortunately run out of time. So let's get to your questions now. You can either enter them in the Q&A section at the bottom of your screen, and if we don't get to your questions today, be sure to reach out to us directly. Our contact information is on your screen and in the guidelines at arts.gov. So I'm going to hand the microphone back to Cliff now so he can manage these questions. Cliff?
Hi, Anne. I'm going to ask you to stay on screen, though, if you could, because we have a number of questions that have come in, maybe even the most frequently asked question that I've seen here. Is organizations and who are looking for guidance on how to select the amount of funding that they are going to be going after, and I'm going to throw this to you to answer. And if you could also fold in there kind of an additional popular question, which has to do with when we talk about small organizations. How small are we talking about?
So I wonder if our colleagues can join us on this part for the questions too. But the second question, how small? So we're encouraging smaller budget organizations, especially those who have not applied, to apply for this ARP funding. And I already forgot the first question.
The first question is really, people looking for guidance in terms of
how to decide what amount to go after. Obviously, if you're a smaller budget organization with fewer resources and the capacity to manage a larger grant is probably not in your wheelhouse, then you want to select a smaller amount. So in this case, unlike most of our NEA funding, where you might apply for a $50,000 grant, but only come away with $30,000. That's not the way this works. So it's either all $50,000 or an answer no in this case. So you want to be thoughtful about what you want to accomplish and how your budget can show your capacity to make it happen.
Great, thank you, Anne. Okay, so another commonly asked question has to do with whether these are all or nothing grants, right? Which is not how we would characterize that, but I think you get the gist. And so I will, just for variety, I'll throw this to Nancy.
Thank you. I'm sorry, and could you repeat that just one more time? I was typing in the
I was answering another question. Yes, people are wondering if let's say they're requesting $50,000, is there a possibility that we might make an award for less than that?
These are designed to be all or nothing. So it's another reason to be very selective when you are deciding what amount to apply for. So the answer to that question is no, you wouldn't get less. It's one of the three options.
Thank you. So I have a question here for Meg. Meg, if an organization asks for $100,000, and they indicate a two-year time period, that would be $50,000 per year. Is that correct?
Not necessarily. So the way that our grants work at the NEA is you're recommended for a specific amount of funding, but then once you have been notified that you received a grant from us and we do all of our processing and actually make the award, when it comes to actually drawing down those funds, we release payment based on when you incur your costs. And so that's something to think about, particularly with these ARP awards, because say, for example, if you know you want to apply for salary support, we wouldn't necessarily be able to release the full grant amount all at once, unless you are incurring those costs early on in your grant period. And so, you know, I would definitely recommend taking a look at your organization's budget, your cash flow, and thinking about what would work best for you. Because when you go to submit a payment request to us, it has to be for costs you've already incurred during your grant period, or as an advance for costs you expect to incur within 30 days from when you actually submit that payment request. So if you were to request salary support for one position, you may be looking at a situation where you could submit a payment request, you know, every month to draw down a portion of your award. But what we don't do, we don't just cut you a check for the full grant amount and send that right to you. These are done like the rest of our grants on a reimbursement basis.
Okay, thank you. Now don't go away, Meg. Somebody wants to know, actually many people want to know, if they received NEA CARES Act funding designated for a specific salary, you know, for specific salary support, can they apply for the same support for the same position with ARP funding?
Yes, as long as the costs do not overlap. So for example, if you received a CARES Act award from us and it was supporting your executive director's salary, if that grant is going to end December 31st, 2021, and you know you want to apply for an ARP grant for that same person's salary, the ARP grant can't start until January 1st, 2022. So there won't be any overlap in time. And so even though, yes, it is the same individual, it's the same position, it's for a different time period. What we can't allow is double dipping or overlap of costs. So if you do have either previous grants from us, whether they're CARES grants or any of our regular grant programs, but also if you have grants from other federal agencies, the NEH, or if you, received a PPP loan, if you're applying to any of the Small Business Administration's COVID relief programs, that is okay. You can have those applications out. You can have received those other awards or loans from those other federal sources. You just need to make sure that there is absolutely no overlap between the costs you request support for from us, for ARP, and anything you've gotten from any other federal source, whether it's us or any other federal agencies.
So a follow-up question then for you. If you apply for ARP funds at the state level, are you eligible to also apply for ARP funds from the NEA?
That would have the exact same answer. Yes, you can apply. And you know, we absolutely know that our state arts agencies, regional arts organizations, local arts agencies are fabulous partners to us, and they are working very hard to also distribute some of these rescue plan funds. But it is the same situation. You will just have to be very careful when you're applying that there can be no overlap between the costs you have, the cost you request support for from us, and the cost you submit to any other source, whether it's a state arts agency, your local arts agency, a regional arts agency. The same thing applies. No overlap in costs.
Great, thank you, Meg. All right, Anne, this is kind of a long question, but I'm going to throw it to you because I feel like there's variations of this that show up sometimes in music. The question is this: we're an art museum with a studio art school. Most of the faculty at our school teach part-time, even before the pandemic, and most remain furloughed. If faculty teach part-time with us, but also teach at other places, let's say they're an adjunct at a local university, would asking for salary support for these furloughed faculty members be allowed?
it would be allowed for the portion of time they spend with you. So if it's a half-time employee for your organization, you could ask for the salary support for that time with your organization.
Okay, thank you. And way to follow the thread there on that, on that question. Okay, so here's an easy one for Nancy. Are organizations that are interdisciplinary, let's say they fall outside of traditional theater and fine arts, you know, their mixture of different disciplines, are they eligible for support?
Absolutely. You just really have to focus on the eligibility criteria to apply. So your organization has to be either a nonprofit, part of local or state government, or a federally recognized tribal community, and have a 3-year history of arts programming. So the arts programming can be interdisciplinary.
Great, thank you. Okay, Meg, a question for you. The guidelines state that, quote, generally a grant period of up to 2 years is allowed, end quote. If we, a potential applicant, request funding for a part-time position, can employment be for a 24-month period, or must the 2-year period include any NEA required closeout activities?
Interesting. If I'm understanding the question, I think there's two different things at play. So if part-time positions are absolutely allowable, we can definitely support part-time salaries. They just need to be prorated appropriately. So if you ask for a 2-year period of performance, a 2-year grant period, but you have a particular staff person who only works part-time, you should only include in your budget costs for their time spent working for your organization during the 2 years, even though, you know, for them, it's not 2 full years of work because they're part-time. But, you know, when you're thinking about, you know, your payroll and you're looking at their timesheets, it would be for work done during the 2-year grant period. But then I did hear a question about reporting. So for all of our NEA grants, and this includes the rescue plan grants, you will have 120 days after the end of your grant period to work on and submit your final reports to us. We know that there is work involved in creating those reports. So you can't charge costs for time people spend working on them after the end of the grant period, because all of your costs have to be incurred during your grant period. But you do have that 4-month window where you can work on compiling those reports for us, so you don't have to race and do them right for the, you know, to hit that same date as the end of your grant period. There is that 120-day window.
Thank you, Meg. Okay, so we have been receiving quite a few questions about award sizes, and, you know, some questions about maybe some of the thinking behind that. So I just wanted to circle back to that. To echo what my colleagues have already said, in terms of the funding levels, this is not meant to be punitive, if that makes sense. So giving multiple award options was designed to balance flexibility for you as potential applicants with the agency's ability to process a year's worth of grants through the ARP program. So we're looking for, with this, flexibility for the applicants, for organizations and a system through which we can get these critically needed funds out the door as responsibly and quickly as possible. We will work with organizations directly on this, so please stay in touch. And we encourage you to read through the guidelines and the frequently asked questions, as there is some guidance in there in terms of helping potential applicants assess which of those three dollar amounts that they should go after. And as a reminder to also, we as the NEA staff pride ourselves on being public servants in the arts. We are here to answer your questions, not just on this webinar, but also afterwards and in the weeks leading up to the application deadline. I also, just to kind of take this an additional step further, we mentioned at the top of this webinar that we are interested in serving organizations that have not previously been funded by the NEA in the past. And we recognize that, I'll speak for myself. I think that as somebody who's dedicated to connecting organizations that have not received funding in the past from the NEA, I try to take an approach that this is really that the ARP funding is really the first opportunity of a number that are coming throughout the year. This is the ARP funding opportunity, but we are very much dedicated to extending all of our grant programs to communities that have not been or felt served by our agency. It is a tough way to meet people through grant making. And so we try to take a view that this is the beginning of a dialogue. We know that this will be an extremely competitive process and a difficult process. We are committed to working with you as applicants, whether you're first time or longstanding applicants, through this ARP process and beyond. I hope that makes sense and that if people have questions about that, please feel free to reach out to me directly.
Cliff, I see also related questions, a lot of questions in the chat about, are certain costs more likely to be covered than other costs? In other words, is there a hierarchy of what you're asking for? And the answer is no. And the other thing I might just add, because I think, I am the one on this call who used to actually be on the other side of the process applying to the National Endowment for the Arts. And I just want to say that we know it's difficult and we're eager to help you. I was known to swear like a sailor when I was completing my applications. So we're eager to be helpful. And also, the colleagues I have at the National Endowment for the Arts are all really generous and eager to help. So I think there's a situation sometimes where we think the federal government is just this big building and, gnomes work there, but they're really nice people who work there and we're eager to help.
Thank you, Anne. Okay, I have a question here for Christine Gant. Christine, if you're there to answer a question, which is about whether the slide deck would be available for download after this presentation. My understanding is that that this presentation will be archived online. Christine, can you give some detail to that?
Hi, Cliff. So the recording of the webinar will definitely be sent to all registrants of this webinar. And since the slide deck will be part of the webinar recording, then everyone will have a copy of the information that we presented today.
Thank you, Christine. Okay, so I'm gonna try to combine two questions into one that are popping up in a number of different ways here, and I'm gonna throw it to Anne, so get ready, Anne. All right, One, this is from a would-be applicant. They're interested in applying for general operating support to support dancers' salaries. In the program description box, should we write general operating support or should we describe our season and community programming? That's part one. Part two that I'm rolling in from somebody else's question is whether we as an agency, whether in the adjudication process, if the NEA prefers funding specific types of expenses over others, meaning, and this is how one of the questioners has framed it, would we prefer to see funding going to artists' salaries over something else?
So yes, we can fund dancers' salaries, and you should just in your explanation say, these salaries will help our dancers do X, Y, and Z. And on the budget, I would just write dancer salary, X number of dancers times X amount of money, so that we know how that would be distributed. And as an agency, no, we don't have a hierarchy of expenses. In other words, if you ask for support for your artistic director and also for your executive director, we're not gonna say, oh, the artistic director is certainly worth more or more valuable. You tell us what you need, lay it out in a way that we can consider it, and no matter of expenses will trump others.
Thank you, Anne. Okay, this is a question that I'm gonna throw to Meg. And if Meg, you're not the right person, then we'll pivot to Nancy. Here's the question. We are a college that has a performing arts facility that does not stand alone as a separate entity. Would we be able to apply specifically for our performing arts facility as opposed to the entire college? If so, could we apply with the budget information just for the performing arts facility as opposed to the entire college?
Yes.
Great, thank you. All right, a question for Nancy. What is the grant period considered to be? What are the options that somebody has in terms of what to list as the grant period?
So I've noticed in the chat that a lot of people are asking about a grant period of either 1 or 2 years, and it's entirely up to an organization. So you can, if you request and receive $100,000, let's say, the grant period starts on January 1 of 2022, and you can take up to 1 or 2 years to expend those grant funds. But you have to let the Arts Endowment know, so when you're doing your budgeting, take a look at your overall budget and what you're going to need, and it might be advantageous to ask for a 2-year project period. You can always close out a project early, but it's so you may want to give yourself that latitude. Or if 1 year makes sense, just say 1 year.
Great. Thank you.
A personal anecdote I'll add, if you don't mind, is when I worked on my NEA grants, I always started with the budget. Once you know how you're going to spend the money, the rest becomes very clear about how to frame it. So if you start with the hard part, get out your abacus and do the budget first, that seems to be a good way to go about it.
Okay.
Cliff, can I jump in here?
Please, yes.
I've seen a bunch of questions be submitted about fundraising or development staff, and costs for fundraising and development staff are only allowable under this program just for the time that those staff people would spend managing this specific ARP award from the NEA. General fundraising activities and development activities for your organization are not allowable costs for this program. So if you, you know, have a grant writer or a development person and they're doing, you know, they do their day-to-day work of, you know, submitting grant applications to other funders, setting up events for fundraising, their salary time is not allowable for this program.
Thank you, Meg. Okay, Anne, I'm gonna do this combo thing again, the two-part thing.
You're testing me to see if I can remember both questions.
Yes, it's like Sudoku or something like that. So, all right, so can funds be sought for programmatic expenses? And then follow-up question, can an organization apply to the NEA grants for organizations program and the re-granting program through our state arts agency?
So you can apply for grants for arts programs and for funding through your state arts organization. That is allowable. And in terms of funds being sought for programmatic activities, for ARP funds, the answer is no. Now, let's say you have a professional choir and they're rehearsing for any number of performances. The fees to pay your professional choir would be allowable, but unlike our typical funding, which is about a project that's narrowly defined and all the costs are tied to that one project, this is general operating support. So you can ask for support for rent and other kinds of things that you might not always put into a programmatic grant.
Okay, thank you. All right. That is a very popular question. Okay, so I'm gonna ask a question that we've kind of danced around a little bit before. I'm gonna throw it to Meg again, just to reiterate, because it's such a popular question. If an organization has applied for SVOG through Small Business Administration, but have not heard about their application status yet, would this preclude them from applying for our program, our ARP program?
You can apply. I do know that SBA, those decisions haven't all been made yet. So I do, you know, understand how difficult planning can be for some of this. But I would maybe recommend just comparing the different types of allowable costs, because the programs through the Small Business Administration do have slightly different allowable costs than our American Rescue Plan program. And so, you know, perhaps it might make sense for your organization to, you know, come to us with costs that wouldn't be covered by the Small Business Administration. In any case, you know, at the end of the day, there can be no overlap. And so if you were to be recommended for a rescue plan award from us, and once you get that recommendation, you know, you can come back and tell us, you know, look, we got support from SBA for these expenses. You will have an opportunity to revise your budget if you absolutely have to. But, you know, do be proactive when you're planning your applications and sort of try to anticipate those issues ahead of time.
If I
get any point across.
So I have two, Meg, I have two allowable cost questions for you. One, for a presenting organization, can they use the funds for artist fees? I've got a second question for you, but I'll let you answer that one first.
Yeah, I would maybe send an email with your particular situation so we can give you better advice.
Okay. Now here's a specific question.
Cognizant of the fact that we're running out of time.
Yeah. If an organization is and this is, I guess, COVID specific. If an organization is making changes to its AC system to meet requirements to provide increased ventilation and outside airflow to a performance or rehearsal space, would those costs be allowable?
No. Renovation costs, construction costs, capital costs are all unallowable. So updates to your HVAC, constructing outdoor facilities, anything like that would not be an allowable cost for this program.
Okay, thank you. Again, one of the most popular questions. I'm trying to be mindful of time here, so if somebody needs to be timekeeper with me, just tell me to cut it out. Can we give some sort of definition of how we define small and medium-sized budgets? I didn't pick somebody on this one. Don't make me pick.
Nancy.
Nancy.
I'll jump in and say I believe that that is self-selection. We'll just leave it as self-defined and self-selection. And Christine has let us know that we need to wrap up. Can I just get real nuts and boltsy very quickly? A lot of people are asking if they can submit their SF-424s. That's the application for federal domestic assistance through grants.gov. Can they do it now? Yes, they can. The opportunity is open. Do it as soon as you can. You don't have to wait, and please don't wait till August 12th. If you're able to apply, submit that form now, go right ahead and do it. And then the other thing is, get a tall glass of water, something nice and cool and refreshing, take a deep breath and sit down and just read through the guidelines. There's a lot of clicking you have to do to go through all of the various aspects of the guidelines. So just give yourself some breathing space to do that. And if you have questions, let us know.
Thank you. Thank you, Nancy. I'm assuming that we're getting our call to wrap things up. I want to say thank you to our ASL interpreter. I want to thank my colleagues, Anne and Meg and Nancy, Christine and Ra, for taking part in this today. I want to thank everybody who's taken the time to attend this session. We know that there have been so many questions, and we hope that we've been able to answer something close to most of them. We do encourage you to follow up with us directly with specific questions that you might have, whether that's within the discipline that you identify with or to our general email box. We wish you the best of luck in this. We know that this is a difficult time and a difficult process, we are here for you to serve in the best way that we can. We wish you well, and thank you.